I ran music schools for 30 years. So I'll give you my thing very quickly. I went to Oberlin. I studied, after Oberlin, I studied for the better part of a year with Nadia Boulanger in Paris, and then I bagged groceries and substitute taught for a year, and then I went to Harvard, where I studied with Leon Kirchner and Earl Kim. And by the time I was finishing my PhD at Harvard, I was already an instructor at BU and had one child and another one on the way. And that's significant because that change, you know, when you need to find medical care and clothing and shelter for children, it changes how you think about your career. I had the opportunity to go into administration, which was much less treacherous at that time for me than being a professor for various reasons. And I took it. And I always was ambivalent about that choice. I eventually became the director of the BU School of Music. I was at BU for 16 years, but I was a director for six. And then I did 1 year, like a vacation, teaching at MIT. It was wonderful. You know, the students were brilliant. And then I was the chairman of the music department at NYU for 3 years. And then I was the director of the Peabody Conservatory for 10 years. And then the president of Manhattan School for 7.5 years. By the end of that, I'm 65, just to give you that sort of a perspective. By the end of that, I was feeling more and more urgency just to be composing. I was composing all along and I was getting performed, but I felt that I was dissipating my energy. And I think the issue for composers in particular is you have a lot of organizational skills that you're not even aware of. If you write music, you have organizational skills. Whether you can transfer them to actual other organisms is not always the case. Some people are good at this and some people aren't. But you will be asked to do things because you're available and because you're not actually preparing a piece. You know, for example, I learned to conduct in self-defense. How many of you do that? Raise your hand, right? How many of you train as conductors? Right, almost a few. A lot of training or a little training?
Little.
Yeah.
A lot.
All right. Okay. You find it helpful as a composer, yes?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I thought it was more helpful as, like, prospects for doing things. That's the
Well, then that's the other part of this. Now, I found that actually being administrator was a tremendous impediment to me doing things. Because if you're running a school ethically, it's not about you. And as a composer, it's all about you. You know, so I was leading this kind of double life. You know, I would get things done in my various institutions, but as a member of the composition faculty, you know, I was very careful not to have more done than the other people, not to push your weight around, because it doesn't work. People work with you, why? Because they love you and they love your music. That's why they work with you, after the first piece.
The problem is I have a lot of plans of orchestrational things I want to do, and then on the other hand, what I've written and what's come on the paper is completely different.
Yeah.
So the question is, like, am I getting off track or should I combine the two or, you
know? Well, my experience is, which you're not my mind or minds are completely wired differently, but my experience is what you hear and what you write down is actually the piece.
Yeah.
What you plan to do is not the piece.
Uh-huh.
So if you're hearing something and it's very insistent, and it's very persistent, you probably should compose that out and see where it's going. That doesn't mean you can't go back to plan A if it's not going where you want it to go.
Mm-hmm.
But your mind, you know, we have this incredible critical facility. We're taught in our culture to be critical. And it's really a problem for creative people. It's a problem for composers because we tend to reject things before we've created them. Oh, that won't work, you know. Sometimes you have to sort of suspend the sort of the frontal lobe cognitive stuff,
mm-hmm.
get somewhere between that and the lizard brain and see what happens. That's my advice. The issue of how you divide up your life is a very important one to me. And the other piece that's important is what's happening to the music world today. I am actually very sanguine about what's happening to the music world today. Yeah, it's being destroyed so that it can be rebuilt. It's not being destroyed because it's over. It's being destroyed because it's dysfunctional and because the repertoire is changing and because the way people experience music is changing. And the people who can save it and know how it should work are you, the best musicians, the best performers, the best composers. What you need from my generation is advice and assurance, but you shouldn't follow our instructions because we don't understand what's happening completely as a generation. You know, all of those music executives, those recording executives that say that the recording industry is dead, you know, I'm a very kind of left-wing person, but it's like all those articles in the Atlantic magazine about how the world's going to hell in a handbasket. What those articles are really about is how white men can't run this anymore, so it must be unrunnable. Right? That is the only logical conclusion they come to. You know, and the truth is, everything's changing. And I am blessed with children who understand this, and also many, many students that I worked with who understand this. And the skills that you need in order to become a successful composer now, I am just really learning firsthand. They're not unlike what I thought they were, but actually walking the walk for the last 3 years is very different from sitting behind a desk, you know, with my salary and my medical benefits and everything else, and basically saying, well, this is, you know, entrepreneurship, this is what you should do. I started a big entrepreneurship program at MSM, and that's exactly right. But the content of that program should not be dictated by the likes of me. It should be dictated by the likes of you.